So Dr. Carilla Tamura is Associate Professor of Medicine at Stanford University and also at the VA Palo Alto Geriatric Research and Education Clinical Center. She is an epidemiologist and health services researcher whose work aims to improve the quality of care for older persons with chronic kidney disease. Dr. Carilla Tamura leads several NIH and VA-sponsored studies, including serving as co-PI of the USRDS Special Study Center on Palliative and End-of-Life Care for Patients with ESRD. Please welcome Dr. Tamura.
I'm really excited to see such a large turnout at this conference because this is exactly the sort of thing that we in the nephrology community have been hoping will happen at the local level for a really long time. So what I want to talk about today, I want to follow on Sarah's great talk and step back and give you an overview of what's happening at the national level and at the healthcare system level. We're all providers here, but we're all also part of healthcare systems. And many of us, I suspect, are leaders of clinical organizations within those healthcare systems, be it medical directors of dialysis units, nursing or clinical directors of hospice units or palliative care programs. And we have an important role to play in shaping the healthcare system that we practice in and that our patients experience. And so I want to talk about a little bit today, first give you an overview of the palliative care needs of our patients. You've heard a little bit about that already today. And then talk about some of the facilitators and barriers to palliative care from the health system perspective. And then finally, I'm going to talk a little bit about approaches to improve palliative care. So first, I want to just talk generally about the healthcare value crisis that Medicare is facing. We know that healthcare costs are high, although they seem to be in a plateau phase very recently, and maybe that's good news that the cost curve is bending, and that all too often the quality of care that patients receive is poor. And this is demonstrated on this slide. The left-hand panel is showing the number of ICU days that patients with Medicare experienced during the last 6 months of life. And you can see that this is high and growing. So on average, patients spend about 4 ICU days in the last six months of their life. More striking is on the right-hand side, the percentage of patients who see 10 or more doctors in the last 6 months of their life. More than a third of patients see 10 or more doctors in the last 6 months of their life. And really, there's no population of patients for which these problems are emblematic than in the end-stage renal disease population. For those of you who aren't in the nephrology community, just a little bit of information about the ESRD program. You'll see that if we talk in terms of absolute numbers of patients, middle-aged patients, those between age 45 to 64, still constitute the majority of patients in the end-stage renal disease program. Fortunately, incidence rates of end-stage renal disease in those in younger age groups seem to be stabilizing or even perhaps declining a little bit. But where there is potential cause for concern is in the older age groups, those above 65, and in particular those above 75, where incidence rates are still increasing. And if we look at the costs of dialysis care, we know that the costs of dialysis care increase with the patient's comorbidity. So on average, the annual cost of care is around $60,000 per year. But if we look at, for example, a 75-year-old patient who has end-stage renal disease in addition to diabetes and heart failure, the cost of care exceeds $100,000 per year. Now, unfortunately, for all of that healthcare spending, the patients still have quite a high burden of residual symptoms. So we're not really doing enough to address their quality of life. And this slide is showing the patient's burden of fatigue, dyspnea, pain, and insomnia relative to patients who have COPD or heart failure. And you can see that patients with end-stage renal disease, here it's labeled CRF or chronic renal failure, have similar or higher burdens of symptoms than patients with these other conditions. Now, what are some of the issues? Well, one of them is that care is extremely fragmented, and that's in part because dialysis facilities are little silos away from other places where patients get medical care. And so it's extremely difficult to break down those silos and get information transferred from one healthcare setting into the other, either from the hospital to the dialysis unit or to the dialysis unit over to the primary care provider. It's also really difficult for patients who have to be at a dialysis unit 3 days a week to go and seek other ancillary services that they might need, whether it's mental health care or palliative care. And vice versa, it's really difficult to get those services into the dialysis unit. So how do we try to break down those silos in order to address what the patients need? Well, on the flip side, there are some potential facilitators of palliative care. A monopoly or duopoly is not often considered a good thing in terms of innovation, I'm going to choose to be positive here and note that Medicare is the primary payer for 80% of patients, and two for-profit companies control about 67% of the dialysis market share. So between those entities, there are about 215,000 dialysis patients. If we can get these major players to embrace the concept of palliative care and its importance in end-stage renal disease, wow, what a big difference we could make for a whole lot of patients. There are some other potential system-level facilitators that I wanted to mention that those of you who are not in nephrology may not be aware of. A value-based purchasing system known as the End-Stage Renal Disease Quality Improvement Initiative was implemented by Medicare in 2012. And so what that means is that Medicare is now paying dialysis facilities not just for each dialysis treatment, but also on the basis of attaining certain quality indicators. Now, we can argue, and many have, about whether they are including the appropriate quality indicators. But that framework is there and could be built upon. Second, there are quality measurement and reporting systems in place in order to help track and implement the QIP, and it's known as Crown Web. There's also the USRDS, the United States Renal Data System, which I'm a part of, which monitors the quality of care that patients with end-stage renal disease receive. And finally, there are elements of multidisciplinary care that exist in most dialysis centers. As you are well aware, there are nursing staff, there are social workers, there are nutritionists. Those are elements that we can build upon to provide quality palliative care for patients with ESRD. Okay, So those are the positive aspects. So now what are the barriers to palliative care? And I'm grouped them into three different barriers. There are barriers in access to care, barriers in the capacity to deliver palliative care, and really that's a workforce issue, and barriers in the evidence base for practicing palliative care. So Sarah alluded to the ABIM's Choosing Wisely campaign. Part of their campaign, they had top five lists for all medical specialties. So I thought I would sort of borrow on that and come up with my own top five list. What would be my top five wish list for things I would like to see implemented to promote palliative care in ESRD? So the first would be universal screening for palliative care needs among patients with ESRD, and that's to address the barrier to access to care. So to address the comments that were made right after Sarah's talk and about geographic variation in access to palliative care, this is showing you state-level data on variation in patients withdrawing from dialysis. That's on the left-hand side. And then on the right-hand side is showing you, of those patients who withdrew from dialysis, what percentage used hospice care. And so you can see, first of all, that there is striking variation in the percentage of patients across states who withdraw from dialysis, ranging from 17% all the way up to 44% for some states. Even more striking is that among those patients who withdrew, there is variation in those who subsequently enrolled in hospice. And presumably that's an access issue, that there are some places where there is not access to hospice care, or it's not being offered to patients. Even more concerning than that data is this data. And let me take a few minutes to explain what this is. It's a little bit complicated, but I think the point that it makes is important. So some of you may have heard of the Dartmouth Atlas of Healthcare. What the Dartmouth Atlas did is group regions of the country based on how much healthcare spending they had at the end of life. And they made the argument pretty convincingly, although I won't go into all the details of why this is that regions that had the highest levels of healthcare spending at the end of life were really practicing a very interventional style of medicine at the end of life. They were putting their patients in the ICU, they were putting them on mechanical ventilation, they were putting in feeding tubes, but not necessarily extending their life. And so you can see the map that I'm showing you is showing you the variation in spending across these regions, with the very darkest red regions being those regions that had the highest levels of healthcare spending at the end of life, and the yellow regions being those that had the very lowest levels of healthcare spending at the end of life. And this is for all Medicare patients, not just patients with end-stage renal disease. And so Sarah and I's colleague and collaborator from University of Washington looked at this, and she looked at, I wonder whether the incidence of end-stage renal disease, and here we're talking about incidence rates of starting dialysis, varied across these regions, thinking that if people practice more intervention-heavy styles of medicine in high-spending areas, maybe they're also starting dialysis more. And in fact, that was the case. So if you look at older white Americans, those who lived in the highest spending areas had higher rates of starting dialysis than those who lived in the lowest spending regions. And a similar pattern was present in Black Americans, although only at the very oldest age spectrum. More importantly, the patients who started dialysis were not in the higher spending regions, didn't actually live longer than the patients who started in the lowest spending regions. They were more likely to die in the hospital, they were less likely to withdraw from dialysis, and they were less likely to enter our hospice program. So consistent with what we've seen from other aspects of the Medicare program, there is something about the geographic region where you live that dictates the sort of care that you get. And then Sarah has already alluded to this study. If we compare patients with end-stage renal disease to those dying from cancer or heart failure, we know that patients with end-stage renal disease receive much more aggressive care. They're more likely to be hospitalized. They're more likely to be in the intensive care unit. more likely to die in the hospital and less likely to receive hospice care. So what can we do? So to address this, what we've suggested is universal screening. And there are lots of stakeholders. There are nephrologists, there are dialysis providers, there are insurers, there are clinical organizations. And how could we implement this? Well, I have two suggestions. One, screening patients with the surprise question, and I'll talk about what that is in just a second, at transition in care. So for example, when a patient comes to the dialysis unit to start dialysis, or when the patient has a hospital admission. And second, use standardized symptom assessments with treatment algorithms for pain, depression, and other common symptoms. So let me show you an example of how this could work. This was a clinical trial where they screened hospitalized patients with a serious illness with a surprise question. Would I be surprised if this patient died in the next 6 months? And if the answer was no, I wouldn't be surprised, then the patient got randomized to a palliative care consult versus usual care. And so in this study, what they found was that there was no difference in their hospital length of stay, in their median survival, or the time from the admission to hospice. They were, however, in hospice for longer. There was an increase in the percentage of patients who had advanced directives. There was no difference in quality of life, but though there was a modest improvement in their satisfaction with care. And there were very striking reductions in the overall cost of care, primarily due to keeping patients out of the ICU. This is a similar study, although done in the outpatient setting. Again, randomizing patients with a serious illness, not ESRD, however, to palliative care consult versus usual care. And here, again, they saw improvements in some aspects of symptoms, so reductions in patients suffering from dyspnea or sleep disorders, as well as reduction in the burden of clinic visits. Although in this study, they didn't see differences in the cost of care. So what about symptom management strategies? Well, if we look just at the prevalence of various symptoms in patients with end-stage renal disease, this is a study where they surveyed patients with monthly symptom surveys. And they focused on three in particular, erectile dysfunction, pain, and depression, because there are readily available treatments for each of those symptoms. About 90% of men on dialysis suffer from erectile dysfunction. About 80% of patients reported pain that persisted over 2 months, and about 30% of patients had depression. They then randomized patients into management of those symptoms with a nurse or nurse practitioner, reasoning that the nephrologist is really busy. They may not see their patient very frequently. I have to be very careful here. They may not feel like they have the expertise to manage these symptoms. So they had a nurse manage these symptoms based on a standard protocol. In the other group, they gave the physician a report of what symptoms their patients met and an algorithm for how to manage them. What they saw is that the treatments that were implemented, the nurse actually was less likely to implement pain management strategies than were the physician management group. Very few in both arms implemented treatment strategies for erectile dysfunction, and about similar percentages implemented treatment for depression. So how about their effect? Well, you can see that the nurse managed group had no significant effect on pain, a modest effect on erectile dysfunction, presumably because very few treatments were actually implemented, and a modest effect on depression. There were similar sorts of trends in the feedback group. So one might look at this and think, well, this is only sort of modest. Is it really worth doing? But these were improvements over usual care. And what I think the study sort of needs to address, or a follow-up study needs to address, is why were so few treatments implemented? And presumably they could have seen a larger effect if more treatments were implemented. And is this the clinician being reluctant to prescribe therapy, or is it the patient being reluctant to receive therapy? And as many of you know, these patients take a lot of medications. There may be reluctance on both sides to add to that list. So this is a study that addressed these issues in a different way with non-pharmacologic therapy. They randomized patients who met criteria for depression to a psychosocial intervention, basically chair-side therapy. They actually gave the patients the option to come into the psychiatrist's office, but uniformly all of the patients elected to receive the therapy at the chair-side, which is not surprising to us who are in the dialysis field, because we know our patients are already going to a lot of visits and they don't want to see anymore. And so they don't mind that maybe their neighbor in the chair next to them hears a little bit about their therapy because they already know what's going on. So in any case, they randomized these patients to chairside therapy, psychosocial therapy, versus a delay in the implementation of chairside psychosocial therapy. What they saw is that the treatment group had substantial improvements in their depressive symptoms, measured both with the Beck Depression Inventory and with the Hamilton Rating Scale. They had substantial improvements in their quality of life, and they had improvements in their intradialytic weight gain. So they had less fluid gain between dialysis treatments than the group that was not treated, which is a big issue in dialysis, and all with a therapy that doesn't require that you take an additional pill. So policy number two, incorporate palliative care measures in the ESRD quality improvement program. So if we're going to ask clinical programs to implement palliative care, ideally we really need a way to track what they're doing to address some of the questions that were asked earlier. So what would we want, if we had our druthers, what would we want to track? What do we think is the best metric of palliative care to track? Well, it turns out the National Quality Forum has already thought a lot about this, and they have a list of endorsed palliative care metrics. And I'll provide just a list of that for you here today. But I'm going to talk just a few minutes about the one that I think is probably the most basic and probably the most easy to implement. By the way, this picture is a local picture. I'm not sure if you noticed, but it says Cervante on here, which I got from the Jerry Pal blog. I'm not sure how many of you followed that, but fantastic. So anyway, why measure goals of care documentation? Well, we know from national studies that 43% of deaths are preceded by a treatment decision. And of these, 70% of patients lack decision-making capacity. So at the time when patients need to make an important medical decision, they lack the capacity to do so. And so this seems very basic to me. And that's why we need to get our patients to complete advanced directives, because very likely when they'll need to make a medical decision, they'll be too sick to do it. And unfortunately, we also know from national data that less than a third of ESRD patients complete an advanced directive. So this just seems to me like low-hanging fruit. We can do this. And in fact, that's been proven. The CMS conducted a disease management program study several years ago, and one component of the disease management thing program was implementing an advanced directive. And you can see that this large dialysis organization was actually very successful in getting advanced directives implemented. Of course, success is relative because they went from 0% to 20%. But they were able to increase it by just focusing on it. So we can do this if we really want to. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about the elephant in the room, payment reforms. if we are really going to do this at a large scale level, we need to have payment reforms to support capacity building, to support the infrastructure to do this, to support what it takes to really change how you deliver healthcare. So first, let's address the hospice benefit. That's one of the big barriers for accessing palliative and hospice care for our patients. So what the hospice benefit says is that if the patient's terminal condition is not related to ESRD, the patient may receive covered services under both the ESRD benefit and the hospice benefit. A patient does not need to stop dialysis treatment to receive care under the hospice benefit. Consequently, hospice agencies can provide hospice services to patients who wish to continue dialysis treatment. And CMS has just very recently reaffirmed that this will remain unchanged for ESRD patients, although they've changed a number of other things related to hospice payment. This will remain unchanged, so it's very important for us to all understand. So how is hospice utilized in the ESRD program? Well, the good news is that it's increasing. Hospice utilization is increasing. Although you can see that even among patients who withdraw, utilization of hospice remains fairly low. So overall, only about 15 to 20% of patients who withdraw from dialysis, meaning they've decided they're going to stop permanently dialysis, actually utilize hospice. So again, this seems like low-hanging fruit. This is something that where we can all agree hospice is appropriate, but it's not being utilized. Moreover, we know that in that setting, hospice use is associated with reduced costs of care. So if you look at just the last row, this is among all dialysis patients withdrawing from dialysis in the US. The cost of care in the last week of life is around $3,500. But there's a big difference among those who use hospice, where it's around $1,800, versus those who don't, where it's almost $5,000. Okay, so what are some examples of payment reforms? I'm not going to go too much into this, but I just want to address this because I know it's a big concern for many people. One is concurrent care models. So a model where dialysis plus hospice care is provided for patients who don't have a terminal condition other than ESRD. Perhaps the case number two that Sarah presented at the end of her presentation, those patients, you can make a very good case for why that patient needs hospice, but none of the information Sarah provided would qualify her for hospice unless she wanted to stop dialysis. The second would be a shared savings model. So including non-ESRD services into the bundle, we think that would provide incentives for people to coordinate care and to really focus on things that reduce utilization and improve quality. And finally, compensation for time-intensive services. This is something that has come up time and time again in talking about the Affordable Care Act and has never managed to get into the legislation, but the time that it takes to talk about advanced care planning and so forth, those are things that would be really helpful, I think, to promoting advanced care planning for patients with serious illnesses. Number four, palliative care training for ESRD providers. That's why we're here today, right? Sarah alluded to this. There are never going to be enough palliative care physicians to meet the needs of the ESRD community. There are not. There's a shortfall currently of about 7,500 physicians in palliative care right now today. 40% of hospitals lack palliative care services, and most are community hospitals, as someone alluded to already. So it's incumbent upon us as non-palliative care physicians to try and seek training to address some of those needs. Now, we were sort of interested in this. Some of you know Brigitte Schiller, who's the chief medical officer at Satellite. We wanted to sort of understand what were the perspectives of nephrologists in these areas. So we put together a survey of medical directors from three large dialysis organizations. and we had a reasonable response rate. 64% of them responded. We wanted to get their perspectives on these issues. And the themes that emerge from this are that nephrologists say they feel prepared to discuss end-of-life issues and even to provide prognostic estimates if asked. And this sort of surprised me anyway. What they said was the main barrier to discussing end-of-life issues is patient resistance. Other important barriers they cited were fear taking away hope, poor care continuity, unclear delegation of responsibility. Do I talk about it? Is the primary care physician going to talk about it? Does the hospitalist talk about it? And some lack of confidence in prognostic models. I'm not sure if this patient sitting in front of me is going to thrive on dialysis or is going to pass away in 2 months. What did the patient say? This is the study that Sarah alluded to earlier. They have poor knowledge of palliative care options. They regretted starting dialysis. Sarah talked about that. Most of them were comfortable discussing end-of-life issues, but 90% of them had not discussed prognosis with their nephrologist. So what this tells me is that there's a disconnect between patients and their physicians. We both say we want to talk about it, but we're not talking about it. And I don't know if it's a timing issue. We want to talk about it when the patient doesn't want to talk about it, or they want to talk about it when we don't have time to talk about it. I'm not sure what it is, but hopefully the afternoon sessions will help us understand what are some of those barriers and how we break them down. Training matters. This is research that Sarah, I think, was involved in. Nephrology trainees feel very prepared to address dialysis and other metabolic complications, but they feel very unprepared to address end-of-life issues. And it matters, it affects how they practice, because those who are more prepared for end-of-life issues are more likely to help a patient stop dialysis if that's appropriate. So I'm going to go through some of this quickly. There are an increasing number of resources to train the nephrology workforce. This conference is one of them, but there are others, including the renal physician's guideline on shared decision-making. And I think she just stepped out of the room. She alluded to this document in her questions. But this document is not only online, but there's an app for it. So you can download the app. It has guidelines to help you through difficult conversations, to help you calculate prognostic estimates, to help you screen for depression and other symptoms. So use it, it's there for you. And finally, in just the last few minutes, I will mention this since I'm a researcher and this is what I like to do. We also need to fund palliative care research. If we look at clinicaltrials.gov, that's a registry of clinical trials going on. You can see that there are a reasonable number of clinical trials in end-stage renal disease. I could only find 3 studies of palliative care or hospice in end-stage renal disease. And if you compare that to what's going on in cancer, there's just no comparison. So we are decades behind oncology in trying to build an evidence base for practicing palliative care in end-stage renal disease. And part of it is funding the NIH, what the NIH chooses to fund. If you look at NIDDK, which is the funder of nephrology research, in the last in the years between 2006 to 2010, they funded only one study in palliative care and end-stage renal disease. So that's it. This is my top 5 list. Again, I'm so happy to be here and see this happening at the local level, and happy to take any questions. Thanks for your attention.
You mentioning how patients who feel welcome the care to be delivered at the chairside. And you quoted one study that did that intervention. So I was curious, your perspective in the next 5-10 years in terms of bringing palliative care to the nephrology patient, what kind of models do you see that are done within, say, the Department of Nephrology at the chair side versus when do we utilize the subspecialty palliative care?
Right. Well, I think one thing that we should think about a little more is a nurse practitioner, palliative care provider coming to the dialysis unit. I would love to see palliative care physicians there too, but I know that their time is stretched. So I think we need to think about how do we maximize the workforce that we have. So one model is to have a nurse practitioner who's rounding on the dialysis unit and really focusing on palliative care needs, perhaps after screening patients at the dialysis unit, either with a surprise question or with symptom instruments, having the nurse practitioner really target those patients. This patient really needs an advanced care plan. This patient really needs to have a strategy for addressing their restless legs, their depression, so on and so forth. And then that's a conversation the nurse practitioner can have with either the nephrologist or palliative care physician. It may be different in different places depending on what's available. But that's one strategy that I see that we could probably implement at many places. But I would be interested in your thoughts too from the palliative care perspective.
Well, I think it's something that we haven't figured out because there's this idea of not enough of a workforce. And this idea of, as nephrology, you know, the team in nephrology should do some of this as well. So I think we're still trying to sort it out. But I agree that, you know, however we decide to do this, the patient and the family is at the center. Unless we know what it is that's important for them, we can't really do any of these other things.
Thank you.
Thank you for that wonderful talk. It was really excellent, especially all the studies and all the work that you've done is amazing. Since you're a researcher, I really want to know if there has been any study done in just trying to figure out how many nephrology fellowship programs actually offer a palliative care rotation for their fellows.
I suspect that might be something Sarah may know more than me. because she's done some work in this area.
Do you have an knowledge, Sarah?
I don't have any sure numbers, but I have communications with people as I was have been, you know, surveying people about the education that they have gotten in end of life care. And from what I can tell, about maybe 10% of fellows right now are doing like a palliative care like rotation, but that's growing fast. It seems like.
I think that's important because, you know, you can talk about apps and you can talk about all the possible, you know, chapters of palliative care and end of life care and then volunteer textbooks or whatever it is. How often do we give full knowledge to medical students that may take more practice? No, it's more about supervision, actually discussing that I had this discussion with this patient and this is what is difficult for me, this is what is difficult for me. So kind of really guided
Yeah, and I agree. And so do fellows, because when you ask them what we should be doing to help them, they say, we'd like to rotate with a palliative medicine service during fellowship. So I agree with you.
And terminal presentations, I contacted you on that, and you mentioned one of the barriers is sort of prognostic understanding of who's going to do well and who won't. You know, one of the things that we learned is for the frail elderly population, in fact, non-dialytic therapy, which sounds much better than withholding dialysis, non-dialytic therapy, they actually do very well, maybe even live longer with improved symptoms. How can we get that information out there that nephrologist comes into the room in the hospital and says, you are going to die without with dialysis. You must have dialysis in order to live. You're going to die without hospice. How can we get that prognostic information?
I think a big barrier to nephrologists accepting that information is the quality of the studies that are out there. And this is not a ding against what's already been published, but they're relatively small. They're all outside of the US, and they tend to be of selected patients. So there's a lot of people have a problem accepting that as being applicable to their wide practice. And so what we need are more generalizable, large-scale studies, one which we're working on, so please be patient. But we need knowledge that's a little more generalizable if we want the community to accept it.
Yeah, absolutely. I completely agree. However, the studies also show how poorly they do on dialysis. So pure prognostic information of who will not do well on dialysis, who will die within the next 3 months, whether they're on dialysis or not. That type of prognostic information, we have very good information on, and that could be transmitted to say you are in, you know, that end of your life.
Right. And so there, I'm not sure if the other speakers are going to address this, that is in the RPA app. They also have a separate app called QXMD, Surprise Question, which they have a tool where you can calculate prognosis based on 5 very easily obtainable parameters. I think, Nina, did you have a question?
So just in trying to address kind of the point you raised about how physicians want to talk about it and patients want to talk about it, but it's not being talked about. So what I commonly will encounter in my practice, I'm a nephrologist, is that I'll try to raise the issue kind of to a patient who's approaching the SRD. I'll try to raise issues of, you know, medical management alone, particularly patients who I feel will not do well on dialysis. And usually the first time I'm introducing it, it's a lot of, kind of, it's overwhelming, it's a lot of information. And so I'm very, you know, very careful to make sure, you know, I'll always say, you don't have to make a decision about this today, you know, this is just something I want you to think about. And then when you bring them back and sort of follow up, usually they're still thinking about it. And so this will go on for a few visits. And then sometimes, you know, before you know it, putting a catheter in because you sort of run out of that critical time. And so, and, you know, this might be addressed in some of the breakout sessions later, but just any advice you might have on trying to get them to actually make a decision without them feeling like they're pressured.
Yeah. I totally agree with that. I have encountered many times when a patient fails to make a decision, fails to articulate a decision. And what I try to communicate is the decision not to make a decision is a decision. And it's really frustrating as a clinician because at some point you do really need them to commit to something, even though they can change their mind. You need them to sort of make a decision. And so I try to tell them, and that failure to make a decision will lead to a more burdensome path for you than if you made a decision, regardless of which decision you make. But I agree with you, it's really not easy when the patient just won't articulate what their preferences are.
I'm thinking about video decision support. And the statistic that 61% of people wish they had an issue with dialysis. Are you familiar with the work of Manjula Tamura?
I am.
Do you ever use any of that, the health literacy issue about, do people really understand the decision that they're making? And his premise that if you see it, you'll know it, as opposed to if you hear it, doesn't sound the same. So what's your experience with that?
We haven't used video decision aids yet, but I've seen this tool, and I think it's really promising. I'm excited to see how it rolls out. So what she's referring to is a tool similar to a video decision aid that helps patients decide, for example, if they want to be DNR or not. Someone's developed a similar for dialysis decision making. And so I think it's really promising. I haven't seen any information on what the reception to it has been, but I'm excited to see what happens. I think there's a big need for it.
Is there a URL or article? Good.
His work is online. He has professional-focused videos and also patient-focused videos, and it's called Advanced Care Planning. So just Google Advanced Care Planning or Angelo Volandes, V-O-L-A-N-D-E-S. It'll all pop up.
Thank you. We have room for one more question.
Comment and a question, because it's not really embedded in the information right now. In 1991, I did my doctoral dissertation on decision-making in ESRD therapy. Interviewed 150 patients who had just started dialysis or received a transplant within the previous 6 months. So they were new in the typical jargon. One of the findings, and there are too many to talk about, was that the elderly patients repeatedly, and this was both it was an extended questionnaire, so it's both qualitative and quantitative data, but many of the elderly patients reported to me that their decision making about starting treatment, 61% who said they regretted that they did it, that kind of thing, but they were essentially doing it only for their families, younger, their children. And you see this in a lot of other diseases. It's not just unique to dialysis, that they felt that they were doing it, quote unquote, because their children wanted them to do it, because, you know, their children had decided that they should try this, etc. That sense of obligation. And they were essentially then passive in the decision making, although they signed the forms themselves. And I've always wondered, and I'm not sure, but I always thought, well, maybe my generation's going to be smarter than that and more independent. But that was such a strong recurring theme. And we really don't appreciate the role that goes on at home of those people, to the point where also the family says, well, you deserve this. It's paid for by Medicare. You should use it because it's part of your benefit. I mean, there are all kinds of justifications that families come up with, and they're very difficult to tease out. My interviews usually averaged about an hour and a half to get this body of data. But I think it's very important. We don't see that when we're sitting with families necessarily, because the family takes a more passive role and things have changed. But it's a critical part of this. My question to both you and Sarah is, you haven't talked about the elephant in the room, as we talk about palliative care and hospice care. And I've written about this in the past. In fact, and if you read Lancet last week, some physician said cancer's the easiest thing to die from. You take your pain medicines and mix it with whiskey and you're dead. The elephant in the room, as I see it, is that palliative care and hospice care for these patients does not need to be extended. What we do in the hospital is deny them their easiest form of death, and that is through hyperkalemia, a relatively asymptomatic problem. And in my counseling and education of dialysis patients, I have always pointed out to them, although some of my colleagues think it's wrong, that they are able to undergo a natural death from end-stage renal disease if they simply eat any or all of the things on the list of foods that they are meant to avoid. High potassium foods. Drink the orange juice that you've wanted for months. Eat a hot fudge sundae. Eat Godiva chocolates, or any cheaper kind. Because hyperkalemia will cause death if you stop one or two dialysis treatments without a lot of symptoms, without pain, in a very short period of time.